Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord.
Feels good to be able to eat some pizza. Costco pizza. Oh no, shameless plug, shameless plug. Now when you're poor, you try to use your money as best you can, and we can get a couple meals, at least two or three out of the Costco pizza. So for me, yeah, that and Papa Murphy's at times. Whoosh. But the reason I say that is because I know there's people that get fixated on healthy eating and healthy living, and that's a good thing. I've done that in the past. I've been kosher in one point in time in my life. I've been health food oriented at another point in time. I've seen how there seems to be a phase in Christians' lives that they go through that, I don't know what it is, but normally a born-again Christian will get involved in church, and then suddenly they're involved in some kind of like little mini scheme of selling some kind of health food or healthy way of living or some exercise routine or something that they've got to promote about Christian, you know, healthy living. You know, I know, I think Rick Warren did one. I know everybody that I've ever met, that I've ever known as a Jesus freak, somehow got involved in some kind of little selling scheme where it was like either Amway or some health food or some whole earth, you know, or something in some way they got into. Then they had to tell everybody about it. And then they did it for a while and it worked for them. And then they kind of fade away from it because they realize it's kind of worldly when you involve God into the world, or you put the world into God. You see, God created the world. He doesn't need us to tell us how to eat or how to sleep. You can eat and sleep and drink and just about do anything, because even Paul said, hey, you know, even snakes, you know, now I'm not a snake handler, I'm not going to jump up here and tell you to go grab snakes and, you know, try to use that as a witness, but I'm a person who's supposed to be on a very strict diet. You know, pizza, Pepsi. But when God had me decided to heal me, and I still suffer from the consequences of man trying to heal me, you know, cut me up and fix this and fix that and messed up this and messed up that, that finally when they said I was going to die, that I would not live past 30, and that the very last surgery that I had, they didn't expect me to survive it. And when I got done, I was in pretty bad shape. And so I was shipped off to kind of a domiciliary care where it took me months to recover, which had happened before, you know. Had lots of experiences with Crohn's and surgeries, but they really didn't think I was going to make it this time. And so, one day, I just went back to the old ways. Things that had worked for me in my life, that God and I had kind of worked out in my diet. Hefty was one of them. Because of my retardant metabolic system, I really couldn't chew up foods like most people. Even though it takes me like 50,000 chews, you know, to swallow, because it's a habit of mine. Even before I was sick, I used to do that. Chew on it, you know. I'd chew for a long time. Matter of fact, I'd miss out on most of the food that was going on the table. Like if Mom bought a bucket of chicken, I'd only get one piece because I was too busy chewing on it, gnawing on the bone, and everybody else was scarfing it down, you know, and eating it whole practically, you know, two bites and swallow. Me, I'm masticating it. That means chew, by the way. And so, I miss out on the bucket of chicken. Well, when I got off of, you know, trying to do everything the way everybody was telling me to, I used to live on Fritos, corn chips, and Pepsi. And it was just, you know, the little small bag, because I could afford that, and it was 16-ounce Pepsi at the time in the bottle, you know, pop top. Because the chewing made me feel full, and the Pepsi helped digest, and it gave me a chance to expiate gas. You know, I would burp, so to speak, so that the gas didn't go down into my bowel systems and kind of make me really sick and ill and blah, you know, and have problems. Now, someone out there is going, oh, that's gross. You know, you could put a nail in that Pepsi bottle or a Coke can, and it'll dissolve. And I go, yeah, and you can put a steel girder in your belly and it'll dissolve. Guess what? You got more acid in your stomach than you do in a Pepsi. Hello? That's why you got so much snot in you, so that you don't eat your stomach lining. Oh, I'm sorry, mucus. You see, God is the architect of my health. He's the architect of my faith. He allowed me in my missionary journeys to go everywhere and anywhere and eat everything and anything that I wanted to at any point in time, as long as he was leading. And that's really the point of life. If he's leading you to do something, no matter what it is, he's going to protect you. And that's where people make the mistake about their faith sometimes. They get caught up in, you know, thinking they have to protect themselves. You know, you got to go out and buy a gun. After all, God can't protect you, so you need your gun in order for the gun to help the creator of the universe stop, you know, something from happening in your life, that you're being led by the Lord, so you need a gun to protect yourself in order to, you know, protect your children and your wife and all that, because you're listening closely to God and doing what he says, and you can trust in him, but you better have the gun anyways. Right. After all, it is one of the amendments that you get the right and privilege to bear arms. Right. Did you know that nowhere in the Bill of Rights is your privilege to and right to serve God? Oh, it says you can do your own religion, you know, and exercise that, but it doesn't say anything about serving God. You see, if you're in service to God, you have to do what he says. If you're in service to God, you kind of listen to what he's telling you to do, not go out and do what you want to do whenever you want to do it. And so I smile because I always watch when people go through this health phase and craze. It's kind of like they took all that exercise out of school, and then, you know, all of a sudden kids only learning and not getting any exercise were still chowing down on all the junk food that they got, and guess what? We got fat, happy kids that are dumb.
Dumb, 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 dumb. Oh, well.
If you're gonna eat pizza, you're gonna have to wash it down somehow. To make sure it gets digested and gotten out of your system. Otherwise, you're gonna get kind of fat around the mid-belly. You're gonna get rolls around your sides. You might even get hypoglycemic, or even worse, diabetes, and all kinds of diseases, unless you can metabolize all this because your body needs it. Did you know that being in the world, you need to wash the world out of you? Really, you need to wash yourself, get cleaned up at times, you know, and kind of flush, kind of like what the health food people call a detox. You need to detox your innards from the outards that's affecting you from your spiritualards. Spiritualards? What's that? Well, you know, that's your spirit that's inside. You know, that part of you that is listening to God, that is hearing His voice, that is walking in His ways. And the way you do that is you read your Bible. You wash yourself by the water of the Word. You know, you splash on some faith. Come on, splash it on. You know, like, I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and with my voice unto the Lord did I make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before Him, and I showed before Him my trouble. Oh, so you don't go around telling everybody else's your trouble. You do it to the Lord. Now, some of you, I'm sure, are doing both. And some of you, you know, do this like and share. Well, if 99% of the people really like the Lord or really love God, then they would repost this. No, that's not the way it works. You see, when you're splashing the Word on you, you kind of get some of it to where it goes inside, you know. You kind of taste and see, ooh, that tastes good. I think I'll drink it too, you know. Instead of just splashing the Word on the outside of you, you take some of the Word on the inside of you. I cried unto the Lord. Oh, I cried unto my pastor. No. I cried unto my elder. No. I cried unto my deacon. No. I cried unto my wife. No. I cried unto my husband. No. I cried unto the Lord. Oh. Oh. You mean I got to talk to God about it? With my voice, and with my voice unto the Lord did I make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before Him. So you see, there is a complaint department. But unfortunately, Christians are not listening. They're not splashing the Word in. They're just kind of washing the outside, you know, and kind of doing like, you know, oh, let's just wash our hands. And then let's, now that we've got, you know, we put our hands in the Bible, you know, and we kind of, oh, I can feel it. Brother, I feel it. I feel the Word. But that's all you do is you feel. It's a nice feeling having a Bible, you know. Kind of feels like a Bible. Kind of looks like a Bible, and, you know, I'm glad you can feel it. Kind of feels like leather. Nice feeling. Ooh, that feels good. But if it's just a feeling, you're really not reading. And if you're just reading and not doing, it's really not doing much, is it? You kind of got to follow what it says to do. And then you got to do it instead of confusing it with what you're doing. I don't know about you. I don't know what you're doing. I know what I'm doing. And I'm choosing. Yum. Love the next day pizza. I'm choosing to taste and see that the Lord, He is good, and He's God, and He can direct me better than all these directions I get from people, pastors, places, things, ideas from the internet, ideas from man, television shows, radio shows, talk radio, jock radio, politics, you know, philosophy, health food nuts, crazes, fads, all those other things that tend to get you caught up and excited about. Don't know about you, but for me, I kind of like to follow what God has to say, because, you know, when they told me I wasn't going to live past 30, God fooled them. Thy loving kindness is before mine eyes. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. Your Father, which is in heaven, he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. Be ye followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Jesus also has loved us and has given himself for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Be you kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Jesus' sake, has forgiven you. If you've been forgiven, then you must forgive. Seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart, fervently. You know, not the brethren you get to pick and choose. If you do, you lose. But the brethren that God said are your brothers and sisters. The love of Jesus constrains us. The love of Jesus causes us to love those that we would not have chosen to love, quite frankly. Love your enemies, and do good, and lend, hoping for nothing again. Can we say that again? Love your enemies. Love your enemies. I want to shoot them, Lord. Love your enemies. No, Lord, I'm sorry. I can't go there. You forget it, God. I want to shoot them. Love your enemies. God, I signed up in the service, the military. I took an oath, so help me, God. I'm going to kill my enemies. Love your enemies. You know, but I do love them. I love them enough to die to, you know, Lord, kill them for you. You know, because after all, you're an Old Testament God, not a New Testament God. Love your enemies. No, I'm sorry, Lord. Al-Qaeda, I got to kill them. I'm sorry. It's just part of the law of the land, you know, and people want me to kill them, so I'm going to go do it. Love your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing. And your reward shall be great, and you shall be children of the Highest. For he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. Be ye therefore merciful as your Father in heaven is merciful. God, this Christian thing ain't so easy. No, it's not. You see, part of the problem of the reality of life and the one we're living is that you can choose to live only in this world and think that you have to solve the issues of the world. Or you could live for eternity and recognize that this world is passing away in the lust thereof. So this life is nothing but to obey and to follow Jesus today as you walk in his way and not your way. Because if you follow the world in its ways, you're going to sign up and become the most patriotic person in the world thinking you're serving God. And in reality, you're fighting the very hand of God. And you're resisting the work of His Spirit, which reaches out to the world and says, I forgive you. I have forgiven you, and I will forgive you. I will pardon all your iniquities. I will forgive all your trespasses. I'll do it for one reason and one alone. I gave you my Son. If you've been forgiven, if God has forgiven you, dare you hate your enemies? Dare you go against God? Dare you resist the call on your life to love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return? Walk in His way and you will be children of the Highest. But don't. Not only you won't find the truth, you'll have everyone else telling you their way to get to heaven. where you can listen to God and do it His way.
Save the people, O God of mercy, when the people, Lord, the people, not thrones and crowns, but men. Flowers of thy heart, O God, are they? Let them not pass like weeds away. Their heritage, a sunless day. God save the people. Shall crime bring crime forever, strength aiding still the strong? Is it thy will, O Father, that men shall toil for wrong? Oh, no, say thy mountains, no, say thy skies. Man's clouded sun shall brightly rise, and songs be heard instead of sighs. God save the people.
Thank you.